name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Glory to Jesus Christ.
Glory forever.
С
праздником.
The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, really what we are witnessing here with the Feast of the Annunciation. The Annunciation, of course, is the word we have this announcing of good tidings, but in the Greek is evangelismos, which is the proclamation of good tidings, the gospel, evangelism. Mary was the first person to receive the gospel, the good news that the Messiah was coming into the world, who would be named Jesus, who would save his people from their sins and deliver us from bondage to the devil and bondage to death. And this is a glorious feast, a feast which we all should revel in, those of us who are at home because of the current crisis, and those of us who are here who are able to participate in this and pray for the others who are not here. Because the good news has come to her. What a fearful thing this is. Mary, of course, fears when this angel comes into her midst. And who wouldn't in the presence of the Archangel Gabriel, this great being of light, this noetic being, very different than us, awesome appearance. But if we heard the canon last time, we read the canon, and the canon says she's afraid, but Gabriel responds back to her that it is I who should be afraid. I am in fear. I am in fear and awe of what I am witnessing here, because I am witnessing, of course, God becoming man of a virgin. A thing that shouldn't be possible is becoming possible through the hand of the Most High. That God is becoming man, that men might become like God, as St. Athanasius says, or become God, is what he actually says. Or as a modern writer says, Father Dimitris Stanilau, he says that God became man, that man might become man, fully man, what he was intended to be from the beginning. Both of these statements are true, because God was perfect God, Christ was perfect God and perfect man. Now this fear that she speaks about is something we need to deal with, because we hear often in the New Testament and throughout the New Testament, Christ says, be not afraid, do not be afraid. He tells the people that when he's walking on the water. He tells the apostles that when the boat is shaking. In the Gospel of St. John, he says, in the world you'll have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. Often he says, be not afraid, it's one of his most cited commandments, telling us not to be afraid. Yet we are to have a healthy fear of God. What is this healthy fear of God? It is because he is the one that loves us. We should be in awe of the one who created us, the one who we have fallen short of, the one who has the power over life and death, the one who has the power of creation. Yes, this is a type of fear, but Abba Dorotheus of Gaza talks about the different types of fear. There's that fear of a slave who fears punishment, and we all, at times in our life, go through that period. Perhaps we're in it right now. There are those of us who are as hired servants who want to have a reward from God or our master, as the analogy would go. Or those of us who are actual sons and daughters of God who fear breaking their relationship with their father, the one that loves them. That is the proper type of fear. So there is the fear of God, but we should not be afraid of the things of this world. We should not be afraid of those things that are not God himself. We should not be afraid of viruses. We should not be afraid of other people's insults or other people's ill intentions against us or poverty or anything of this world, because this world is fleeting and will come to pass. It will pass away from us. And yet Christ remains, and Christ remains in all of it. Christ is our sure hope in everything in all these circumstances. So when the Archangel tells her not to be afraid, because the power of the Most High is coming over her, she has no need to be afraid of anything anymore. Obviously she's in awe. Obviously it's the proper type of fear, but not the things of the world, not that anything is going to harm her, because God is with her. And Mary is that one who reverses the no of our mother Eve, who in the garden essentially says no to God because she desires to be God herself, as did Adam as he follows her and eats of the forbidden fruit, who was not blessed to receive, at least not at that time. The time would have come when they were prepared to receive it, but that time was not then. So Mary reverses that by her yes, and by saying, let it be unto me according to thy word. Now think about that, let it be unto me according to thy word. God is the one who often says this in the scriptures, let there be light, let there be land, let there be man. He's the one that creates, let there be this and that, the things that he creates. But Mary becomes a participant, a co-participant in this way of really ultimately creation, of creating, not creator, ultimately according to time, but it's according to the flesh, becomes a participant in her own salvation, as we too must give our yes to God and the things that he has given us in our lives. And her let it be according to thy word must be a message that we all begin to hear ourselves. Because here is a time now, especially when we're all feeling the difficulties of this current crisis, that we must be able to say, let it be unto me according to thy word. If I get this virus, God forbid, I hope no one does, I hope none of us do, but if we do, let it be according to as thou hast allowed. God doesn't will evil. He is not the author of evil. He's not the author of viruses. That is because of the fall and corruption. But he does allow things that will correct us and allow us to come to correction. This is a time he has given us, I believe, personally, rather clearly for our salvation. A time he has given us to re-examine our lives and to see what's important. To examine our life at home now that we have so much time at home to be quiet. And to see what is really important, to ponder who is God, who is Christ, what is my relationship with him, who is the Mother of God, what is the Holy Trinity, and to ponder these ultimate questions, what is the end of my life? If I were to die now, as many of the fathers say, where would I be? To ponder that, and to begin to use this opportunity not to indulge in more self-pity and self-love and turning toward the things of the world constantly, but to turn toward Christ gently with, Lord Jesus Christ, have mercy on me, to read the scriptures, to read the lives of the saints, to fast, to reach out to others who need your help, who need a consoling word, and offer them a consoling word in the time of trial. It's a time that has been given to us for repentance, and I believe for the world for repentance. Throughout history, the fathers have believed when difficulties came, whether it was plagues or Bolshevik revolutions or the Turkopratia or whatever it may have been, that God was giving nations a chance to repent, to turn closer to God. And most certainly our nation and the world has many, many things to repent of and to turn back to God. And ultimately in all that, we have this great advocate before the throne of God, the Mother of God, who the fathers turn to so diligently. The Octine Elders are frequently referred to her as the Queen of Heaven in their prayers. And so these Greek fathers call her Panagia, the All-Holy, that very endearing term. They said, Panagia, help me. Most Holy Theotokos, help us. My Holy Theotokos, save us. Most Holy Mother of God, save me. To call out to her constantly throughout the day, in between your Jesus prayers, to call out to her occasionally, Panagia, help me. I need your help now. I fear. I am in dread. But she will tell you too, do not be afraid. Because as we say in the great compline throughout Lent, God is with us, for God is with us, and that God was with the Mother of God. We heard in the scriptures, rejoice thou full of grace, the Lord is with thee. The Lord is with her, but the Lord is also with us, and through her prayers is abundantly with us. Most Holy Theotokos, save us.
Amen.